Hello, everyone, and welcome. I'm Rajendra Roy, the Chief Curator of Film here at the Museum of Modern Art. It's a pleasure to welcome you to this Q&A for The White Tiger. Before we begin, of course, I want to thank our year-round sponsor for everything film here at MoMA, Chanel, and all of you, our members, for making this virtual cinema presentation so spectacularly successful. I also want to, of course, thank Netflix, who is bringing this film to the world at a time when I actually think it is one of the most vital works of art that could possibly be reaching screens around the world right now. So I want to thank and welcome all of our artists today, Ramin Bahrani, Priyanka Chopra Jonas, and Adarsh Gourav. Welcome to the Museum of Modern Art, sort of.
Thank you so much. God, I wish it could be in person.
I know. And, you know, I am sitting on stage in one of our cinemas and so wish that we were all here in person today to do this. But, you know, here we are and we're going to make the best of it. So thank you for gathering with us.
Thank you. I've seen so many great films there, you know.
Well, I think, Ramin, I was thinking back, you know, we've known each other scarily for over 15 years now. And we've shown many of your films here at MoMA. I knew you before I worked at MoMA, but you know, one of the things about your work that obviously has been a huge draw to me and to millions of people around the world who have been drawn to your films is your embrace of the humanity of the invisible. And often that means the working class, but also the complexity of the individuals who make up those underseen stories, at least on cinematic screens. The White Tiger, in a way, is a perfect vehicle for you, but I'm really curious how you were drawn to take on this adaptation.
Yeah, well, I've been waiting 15 years to make the film because the novel was written by one of my close friends, Arvind Adiga. We were in college together in the mid to late 90s. When we got there, I think we just naturally found the Indians, the Iranians, the Syrians. I remember there was a Lebanese, there was an Afghan, and we just became friends. And I think Arvind and I clicked because in that group, we were probably the ones that wanted to go into arts in some way. Arvind to be a novelist, and I was hoping to be a filmmaker. And it was the start of a almost 25-year dialogue now. And so I've been reading drafts of The White Tiger for almost 4 years before it was published, and just was immediately blown away by the writing. It was, the voice of Balram was so electric, sarcastic, satirical, funny, powerful, sad. And it was incredible. And I just had always wanted to make it into a film.
So then talk to us about the process of pulling this together. Priyanka, I know you are not only one of the leads of the film, but also a producer. There's just a stellar list of folks who were involved in pulling this film together. Talk to us a little bit about, yeah, how it came together, because I can't imagine it was an easy feat, especially for a production that was based, I think, outside of the subcontinent.
I don't think, you know, it probably couldn't have happened 10 years ago. It might not have been able to happen even 5 years ago, but it was kind of that right moment where a company like Netflix is willing to take risks on artistic ventures and also on ventures that don't star only white movie stars. You know, they're interested in global stories. They're interested in authentic stories from other parts of the world, which, you know, is great for someone like me, you know, and the kinds of films I've made. So that was a huge part of it. I think Arvind, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, we were talking and he said, maybe it's a good time to try and get this film made. And so I reached out to the rights holder of the book, which was a awesome producer in India, Mukul Deora, who was the main producer and partner on the film. And he had seen my name, by chance the book was dedicated to me and he had seen that. And he had seen some of my films, so he said, we spoke for an hour, we clicked on what we thought the vibe of the movie would be. And he just said, I think it was destined for it to be this way. And then we just, you know, took it to Netflix. They were on board real quick at Scott Stuber's division. And then it was off to find the locations and the actors, you know.
So let's talk about that. Priyanka, when were you first approached and how did that conversation go down?
So I think... Ramin is being too kind. This movie, like he said, was destined to be made. And from when I came on board, which was a little bit later when all of this had gone down, on my end, it just flew, you know, everything sort of came together like the universe was planning it. Like I read about The White Tiger being made and Ramin directing it for Netflix in the trade magazines. And just as I do every morning, I'm like, okay, what's being made? What's happening? And I read about it. And I remember reading the book when it had come out, I think in about 2008 or nine. And it was one of those books that I didn't put down till I finished it. It moved me, it provoked me, it made me uncomfortable, it made me think. So when I read that, this book was being made, and you know, my quest really since I've started working in Hollywood is to bring to the fore South Asian stories, is to bring to the fore global stories that cross-pollinate cultures on the mainstream. And like Ramin said, having partners like streaming services like Netflix who have the bandwidth to think so large, I just made my agent call them. And I was like, I want to be a part of this movie. I want to act in it. I want to executive produce it. If you will have me, tell me what I can do. And they said, well, you're going to have to meet Ramin. So I was like, you got it. And Ramin and I met, we met a couple of times. We met in Mumbai. This is very international. We met in Mumbai. We met in LA. I auditioned for him a couple of times. We read together.
New York
as well.
Yeah. Remember when that was all possible and we could just do that, right? Anyway,
that's sad. Don't remind me about that, Raj. Oh, but that's what happened. I called my agent. I met Ramin, and we had like at least my side of the story is that I just was so inspired by him the first time I met him. I mean, I'd known of his work and I'd known of, you know, what he stands for, but working with him and being in the same room and, you know, doing a peer-to-peer conversation about what this character was and what she was thinking and what Balram's world was and the world of the movie. It was just, I knew in an instant that I had to work under his tutelage just for an immersive experience that I was really looking for with all the work that I had done. And that's how it happened.
Yeah. Amazing. And we're the better for it for sure. So then on to the discovery, the moments in the film that literally will put the world in a new zone. It certainly put me on the floor when I witnessed your performance, Adarsh. How in the world did you find each other? Talk to us.
I got a call for the audition for the film in the month of May of 2019. Between January to the month of May, I was auditioning very, very rigorously and for a lot of things, everything that came my way. And I couldn't convert any of them. And I was in a space where I was riddled with self-doubt. And I was like, man, is this even something that I should be doing? Because am I even good enough? And you know, all these questions that you have as an actor. And all of a sudden, a couple of projects worked out. And, you know, and White Tiger wasn't one of them initially, like there was something else. And then I got a call from Tess Joseph's office saying that there's an audition happening. And my first thought was that...
She's an amazing casting agent, by the way, from India.
She's Lion, and she's one of the great casting directors.
And I've worked with her before as well. She's amazing. Continue, Adarsh.
Yeah. Thank you.
So I was actually chasing Tess for a while and I wanted to audition with her for a very long time, but... it was hard for me to get an audition with her. And when I finally did, there were two thoughts in my head. A, I said, this movie's too big for me to get anyway. So let's not like, you know, get too ambitious about this. Let's just focus on the film I have in my hand. But then as an afterthought, I said, man, this is the first time in so many years Tess has given me the chance to audition for her. So might as well make the most of it. Let's go and at least audition. And if I have a decent audition, she'll call me for another audition later on. So, you know, just so that I could impress Tess, my primary motivation was to just go out there and just to like make sure I create a good impression on Tess. Because even considering the fact that I would ever get to play Balram was just like way out of my, you know, I hadn't even imagined that. So I just went there with the intention of giving a decent audition. And coincidentally, I had read the book as a teenager. So I had some context to the story as well as the character. And I auditioned for it. And then five rounds later, by the end of June, I think Ramin went back to New York, and then he gave me a call saying that, you know, we want you to play Balram. And, you know, all your life you have this, you've sort of lived this moment in your head when you think that the biggest thing that can ever happen to you, when you hear something like that, you will absolutely flip out. You know, you'll go crazy, you'll run, you'll do somersaults, you know, like you'll do all sorts of crazy things. And I had the most anticlimactic reaction. I was just like, oh, thank you. Because it was so beyond me. I couldn't process the fact that they wanted me to play Balram. It just felt very surreal. So I think, I had a very, very strange and subdued reaction to the whole thing. But that's how I came on board. And after that, we spent a few months preparing for the film and then went on flow by October.
Well, I can say, young brother, that your seriousness comes through in the performance, and it's not a surprise at all that your reaction would be a serious one upon learning. And I also say, I'm like with you on this. I recall 13 plus years ago when I was asked to apply for this job to run the film department at MoMA, you know, I was like, no, they don't want me. I'm 35, I'm brown, you know, like all those things you say in your head. It's not, but I was like, okay, I'll just go and I'll learn something, I'm sure. Yeah. So kudos to you for stepping up and taking that opportunity without knowing what would happen. But what has happened is remarkable. And Ramin, I don't know if you remember what I emailed you instantly after I saw the film. And I was like, who is this young Anthony Perkins? I mean, it was just, your performance is you know, I guess I want to talk about the evolution of characters. And for both of you, for both Bahram and Pinky, there is this evolution of the people we think we're meeting and we discover through the process of the film are very, very different or are capable of very, very complex and different emotions, actions. And I think that is one of the great powers of the film. But maybe Adarsh, you could just speak to how you got yourself in the mindset of going on this journey, on Balram's journey, because it is an incredibly complex one. And complicated in not altogether easy ways.
Absolutely. And one of the first things that I really did was just to pack my bags and go to a village in Jharkhand. And you know, I befriended this guy who used to stay next to my building. And in our third meeting, I told him that I want to come to your village, and he was like, that was too quick. You know, we've just met like two times and you're telling me that you want to come to my house in the village. And then I told him that there was a part that I was preparing for and that, you know, I would really appreciate his help. And we got talking about just our lives and about, you know, our common sort of roots and about our family and stuff like that. And he could really connect with me and he got convinced. And, you know, we went to his village, literally changed five modes of transportation to reach his village from Bombay. And I stayed there and I told him to not tell anybody else that I was an actor, because I just wanted to have like a very unbiased, undiluted experience. And which I did. I saw the village through his eyes. I understood how people were over there and what they thought about the city folk and all of that. And I spent two precious weeks over there, post which I came to Delhi and worked at a food stall. Where I was basically cleaning plates and, sweeping the floor and stuff. And I got paid 100 rupees a day, worked there for 2 weeks, 12-hour shifts. And it was incredible and it was eye-opening and it was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. And there were moments where I would literally like suddenly snap out of it and be like, what the hell am I doing here? You know what? suddenly I'd be in the middle of cleaning a plate using less soap, because if I'd use too much soap, he'd get pissed saying that you can't use so much soap in a day. And I'd be like, what am I doing here? Because there'd be like a big bandicoot running next to me from an open sewer. And then I'd be like, this is exactly what Balram felt when he was in the village. Because he always knew his real potential was much more than just to be confined to the boundaries of a village. And he wanted to get out of that rooster coop, as Arvind Dadiga calls it. So I just wanted to experience that feeling, experience the feeling of anonymity and insignificance. And I stuck around for 2 weeks till the time we started our script reading sessions.
Well, there's a funny story actually, where I needed Adarsh to come for a call back with an actor that just suddenly happened. And I texted him, WhatsApped him, can you be at this place at like 4 o'clock? But he was doing the job. He was cleaning the dishes. He didn't know what to do. So he showed up, and later he told me that he told the owner that he had to run out and buy some bananas for the shop. And then he just kept running and didn't go back. And the next day he didn't know what to do because he didn't have a job. So he told me that he was just like wandering around the streets, and some guys were carrying some huge giant metal, corrugated metal with like spikes on it, and they were loading it into a truck, and they just called him like, hey, you come over here. And they just thought he was a guy that needed work because of, I don't know, his mood and feeling and what he was up to and his immersion. And then he did the work. And then the next day he showed up at the office and his hands were just completely cut up. We had to get him a doctor. And then 1 week later, McCool, the producer, went to a shopping mall, kind of a high-end shopping mall in Mumbai. And as he was entering, he looked, and out of the corner of his eye, he saw Balram squatting with like 10 other drivers waiting for their masters to come. And he realized-
Adarsh.
I thank you. You just called him Balram.
Oh.
He has a tough time calling me Adarsh.
Well, even Priyanka knows, I call the actors by their character name. And sometimes I forget. Yeah.
I'm getting a picture of a very methody set.
Well, Raj, also in my first films, the actors, their names were their real names all.
I
forget. All right. I don't know.
No, all jokes aside, that is incredible commitment. But Priyanka, I wanted to speak to you about Pinky, because her journey is one that for many of us was almost as painful, if not more personally painful, because she speaks to a life that is slightly more familiar, especially to those of us who, live in the West or, have a foot in India, but still have that, kind of Western liberal upbringing. And her character has to go through this recognition of the intense performative nature of empathy, right? Like, she abandons herself and Balram in the process. And that must have been an incredible journey for you to prepare for in portraying her. I'm just wondering if you could speak to that.
Raj, to me, it was such a, Pinky's character was so complex, just like India as a country is. There's not one India.
Right.
There's various kinds of India, just like there's not one America. I mean, we saw that just in the recent events that happened.
Clearly.
And I think that Pinky's character is the voice of sort of urban India, or an Indian that has been sort of, their mind has been opened up to education and the world. And she has been, put into this side of the world where she just doesn't agree with the systemic, cultural, regressive thoughts and behavior that exist within the culture. And, it's such a complex thing to wrap your heads around. And the familiarity of it, as you said, when you watch it, is what should be disturbing. That we are all so familiar with that dilemma, which is actually, when you scratch beneath the surface, not very deep, considering what Balram's story is. And that is a large part of the world. And what affected me about this book when I read it, and what affects me with the movie when I watch it, and I've watched it like 5 times right now. My family is a fan. So every couple of weeks it's put on and we're like, oh, we need to watch White Tiger again. But, when I watch it, the one thing it evokes in me is I feel angry and I feel helpless just when I watch it. And to me, that's what Pinky felt. She was angry. She felt helpless. She wasn't in control of anything, no matter how loudly she spoke or no matter how softly she spoke, who she implored to, or, whether she could stand up for herself or not. And eventually, I think she had to walk out on it because she walked out on herself, like you said. But somewhere, I think she and Balram met in the middle, where she saw herself in Balram, where she was her life was dictated to her because of her birthright and circumstances. And as we know, birthright, where you're born, your circumstances that you're born in dictates people's futures in a large part. And just like Balram, she wanted to pull herself out of the circumstances that were dictated to her. Hence her being the catalyst of change in his life and telling him to look out for himself, think about himself and his choices and his desires, which he does. And his character just pivots. So I think that all of our characters are so deeply entrenched in the complexities that all of us as human beings face and probably are desensitized to as well. But this movie and the book is a mirror to that uncomfortable feeling and that part of the world that all of us kind of know exists but don't want to see.
You know, for me, this film is very specifically Indian in many ways. And I just have to say, point out the joy of being majority South Asian on a Zoom. It's a two rarity. I mean, Ramin, we embrace you, as it sounds like your friends in college did. We warmly invite
you're
you.
You're an honorary South Asian.
Exactly.
I mean, honestly, Raji was kind of cool. Well, you know, I lived in Iran for 3 years. My parents are Iranian. And a couple of things. One, the crew came to understand they have to be a little careful because a lot of the Urdu words they understand.
Oh.
Yeah. So they would say things about the movie or production or money. And I'd be like, oh, I'm picking up enough to put it together.
Yes.
And also it was kind of cool to work on a movie where you're like, I would go up in the elevator to the production office and you know, everyone in the elevator is brown and someone random person just starts talking to me in Hindi. That was kind of cool, actually. You know, it was like, I don't remember being on a film set where I turned around and everybody was brown, you know?
Yeah, it's cool, Ramin. We think you're cool. So, you know, welcome to the club. the film is also very powerfully universal. So the specificity works to the point of making it connect. But I'm wondering if you could just speak, Ramin, you can start, about finding that balance. I mean, there, you know, finding the balance between the specificity and the universality of the story.
Yeah, I just want to go back quickly to what Priyanka said, because I thought it was so well said, and just to recognize how much she brought to that role. You know, she really elevated and enhanced it. I remember we had an amazing meeting in Mumbai where I understood she gelled totally with this kind of storytelling and was producing these kind of films. But then we had our good meeting in Los Angeles where I said, is it possible to do a reading? And she's like, of course. And it was just me and her and my phone. And I recorded it on the phone while reading a part. And she did a really hard scene that I'd struggled with other actors to get right. And she leaned into her own instincts. Even when I said, are you sure you want to try something else? She just went farther into her own instincts and made the scene work in a way no one else had. And so it was great to work with her because what she brought to the film just elevated the part. It made it more complex. And one of the joys of the set was her, Raj, and Adarsh liked each other a lot, the three of them. And you could feel it in the scenes that they liked each other. And that helped.
And we actually hung out.
Yeah, that helped. Yeah, I mean, in terms of what your question about the universality of it, even when Priyanka was talking, at some points I thought she was talking about America, you know? Balram's journey, you know, I think part of why Scott Stuber at Netflix wanted to do it was because of the universality of the story. And when he saw the first cut of the film, which by then I didn't go to LA to show him, it was COVID. It was the end of March. We had just entered lockdown or April. And so we talked by Zoom. And it was kind of scary because COVID has, as we all know, unearthed the fissures and the chasm between rich and poor and the what's lacking in most people. I don't even want to say poor, it's middle class. Americans don't understand when they're poor, they refuse to accept it. So let's say middle class, the struggles are so challenging and the ability to just on a day-to-day basis make it is so tenuous that Balram's existence seems much more relevant to all of us in ways that I've been struggling for years to try to get, let's say, our typical audience to understand, Raj. A lot of people that watch, you know, art house films or films I've made, independent films, and now in the last couple of years, more for bigger audiences, the themes are still, you tend to get middle, upper middle class people watching them. And I remember with 99 Homes, it was trying to be like, guys, what I'm talking about isn't just about brown and black people living in the margins. It's actually about wide sections of the country. And so I think in the story, people might recognize that struggle. They might now very kind of real, in a real scary way, feel the simmering rage that's underneath the film that Balram, that Arvind had captured in the characters. So I'm pretty curious what the reaction is going to be.
Just to add to that, Raj, one second, just because, you know, Ramin, when you say that even the book, when it was written, like the book was so successful internationally, it's about an Indian boy in India. But when the book came out, it was a New York Times bestseller. It was a Man Booker Prize winner, because somewhere it was a story that happened to be based in India, but could be is related to by everyone around the world. And that, I feel, is going to be a reflection on how this movie might be received as well.
Totally.
One of the specificities of Indian, at least film culture, that I think is important to note is this phenomenon of superstardom, right? And it goes to this, I'm really thrilled to know that there was this cohesiveness amongst the three leads, and the other being Rajkumar Rao, who's not on the Zoom, but in fairness, Priyanka, you and Raj are massive stars. And to have Adarsh join that circle, in the one sense, obviously it's what makes the picture work, but in another sense, at least in the tradition of grand epic cinema, I'm just really curious what it was like for you, Adarsh, to join that circle, especially given, you know, that you're shooting on location, you're interacting with, obviously we hear, you know, very real scenes of life in Delhi and in India, and then you're working with these phenomenally known people, obviously human beings, but it is a different type of culture there. Could you just speak to that and you know, Priyanka and Ramin as well, of just facing that, that, you know, really stark reality of fame in India?
Just to quickly set it up for some of the audience that may not know, that Rajkumar Rao is, as you said, a huge star, let's say in a Hollywood sense, but also he's done these amazing indie films that showcase what a tremendously talented actor he is as a character actor. Movies like Shahid, City Lights, Newton. Everyone knows Priyanka, who's a megastar in India as an actor and is now going to show the West a completely different side of what she's doing. And she's now taking her talents everywhere around the world. But also the actor playing the stork and the mongoose, Mahesh and Vijay, those are both also very known actors. Also the guy playing the stork is a famous director there. And the actor playing a mongoose is a famous screenwriter, an award-winning screenwriter. So there's a lot of talent that your audience may not know about, but they're all huge there.
Yeah. And I meant no diss by the megastar thing. I mean, I have tremendous respect for movie stars, but is also incredible pressure, I would imagine, you know.
One more piece of context, Raj. We had a very hard time shooting certain things on location because of, there would be a riot because of Priyanka's presence, honestly.
Exactly. Like, that's what I'm trying to get at.
Literally, yes. A riot.
Yes.
And so we sometimes had to shoot things between 2 to 6 in the morning was our only window, with a lot of security in weird remote suburbs of Delhi that no one knew about. That's how we had to do the film.
No. I mean, and it can happen around the world, right? When we showed, I can't remember which film it was, but SRK, Shah Rukh Khan, here at MoMA, and you had to shut down Midtown. You know, it was like insanity. So anyway, Adarsh, talk to us about entering that group. You'll be amongst those now, but at the time, obviously you could navigate in a different way. And maybe that was even a privilege as an actor.
No, I was extremely excited and inspired to be working with both Priyanka and Raj. You know, I've been a huge fan of both their bodies of work. With Raj, I've all the characters that he's played in films in India have been extremely complex, and they've been very brave choices as an actor. And you know, I've always looked at his body of work and often thought to myself that 10 years from now, this is the kind of body of work that I would want to have for myself, you know, take these kind of risks and do the kind of complex roles that he has. With Priyanka, of course, I've seen her all my life, and when I had to meet her for the first time, I remember I was in the rig, and I was thinking about how it's going to be, and I was playing the situation out in my head, and I was feeling very nervous, and she just instantly put me to ease when I walked into her house. We had met for a script reading, and she was so normal to me that I said, oh, is this how she is? And I was instantly put to ease, man. Like I wouldn't lie to you, and all that intimidation and all of that just went in, like, just that the first time she hugged me, and you know, we sat and we were having some food, and I think the greatest part about her, and what I admire about her the most, apart from the fact that, of course, I mean, she's a brilliant performer and I'm a huge fan of her work in Barfi and Kamina, is just the fact that she has this incredible energy around her, and she'll just make you feel special even if you haven't done anything special. So you feel good about yourself for no reason just by being around Priyanka. You just feel important and you feel good about yourself.
I think that's totally true, because I feel important just on this Zoom with her.
Priyanka, you've got to bottle this and sell it around the world now.
And I kid you not, the days on which Priyanka would be on set, the energy of the set would be something else. Everybody would just have this kind of, like, you know, this sudden surge of energy and this sudden surge of optimism that we're up to something that is very important. And not that we wouldn't have it on the rest of the days, but I did experience that difference in energy when Priyanka was on set, and it was incredible. And similarly with Vijay sir and Mahesh sir, the actors who played Mukesh and Stock, you know, I've been huge fans of both their work, and just overall, I think it was a very, very humbling experience for me to be around these huge actors. But what was really a huge learning experience for me was that once we were on set, we were the people that we were playing. I was Balram and Priyanka was Pinky Madam, and Raj was Ashok, and then these kind of things just cease to exist, and then you just look at each other as the people you're being for the film. So then, like, I think it's only then when true movie magic happens, you know, when you give each other that sort of liberty and space to work around.
One thing to mention, Raj, about, as you said, him not being known, that was helpful. One of my favorite moments in the movie is when Balram is sitting in the streets of Old Delhi, and old beggar woman comes to him asking for money, and he explodes and just kind of goes crazy. Like many times in the movie, Adarsh came to me and said, I want to try something. And then he wanted to tell me what it is he wanted to try. And I would always say, don't tell me. You and every actor on my set has the freedom to do anything you want. You don't need my permission. You don't even need to explain it. Just do it. The camera people know, the operator knows, he'll figure it out, we'll all figure it out. And in that scene, he was just supposed to kind of shoo her away and tell her to get lost, but he did this other thing which you've seen in the film, and that is a completely live environment. We have no control over any of those people except for him and the beggar woman. So once he told me he was going to do something, I just went to the actress playing the old woman and said, whatever he does, no matter what it is, just keep asking for the money over and over again. All the crew was gone. It was just the camera operator and a mic. And then he just did what he did, including shouting at the police. I don't know those police. I thought he was gonna get arrested or something. So he just kind of pulled the whole street into the scene with him. And that couldn't have really happened if it had been a famous actor in India.
Well, I mean, it also couldn't have happened without extreme courage and determination on your part, Adarsh, and gives us a sense of that you really are capable of that. Priyanka, I'm going to pivot to my last line of inquiry, but it actually seems to kind of fit in this, because it sounds like you were the big sister who kept everything together, right? You could have been... you didn't have to be as generous as it clearly seems you were on this set, but one of the themes of the film that really struck me is the oppressive nature of family units in many cases. It's great that on the set, there was a cohesive family, it sounds like, but in telling the story, it didn't matter whether it was a village setting or a high rise in a big city. The family is in a way, both the thing you're most loyal to, but the thing that has the most power to undermine and destroy you. And I wonder if you could just speak to that a little bit of, I mean, and obviously that is, there are, again, very specific things about family units in India. And, you know, I had those experiences with my dad as a kid growing up in the West, but experiencing kind of Indian expectations on families, but also the way that that hits more universally.
I think family and the complexities that come with it is a completely universal topic, and millions of books have been written about it. And we're all aware of, you know, family dynamics that we love, we hate, but kind of, you know, family is what you're born into. You can't choose it. And at the same time, I think every country is entrenched in its own history and its own culture and has its own complexities. As you can see in this fictionalized story of Balram, which is absolutely not a representation of India or culture as a whole. That is something that's really important to understand, that this movie is just a slice of the complexity that is this nation called India, and the complexity of class and the socioeconomic disparity. People are born poor and people are poor and people are rich all over the world. And this disparity is something that we need to be aware of instead of being you know, sort of desensitized to it. And I think that me coming from a very strong family dynamic, you know, I understand all the various versions of it. But just coming back a little bit to, I wanted to address something when it came to Adarsh, that I was cast onto this movie and I became part of the movie before Adarsh came on. And I remember the conversations around who was going to be cast as Balram, and even Raj at that point, Raj's character, which was just about happening. Casting was just about happening. And I had obviously bulldozed my way into this. And I was like, I'm going to EP this. Whatever you need, I'm going to do, because this movie needs to be told and I'm going to, you know, I have to do it. But I remember that Ramin and I had this conversation again at my house once, and we were sitting and talking about who Balram is going to be. And there were a couple of, you know, people that Ramin was exploring, and a lot of them were extremely prolific actors, international and Indian. But he was so clear about Balram's character and Balram being someone who could absolutely be a sponge and be a complete unknown. And we all knew that this was a movie which is a showcase for him. So when you were talking about, you know, the fact that Raj and I have the privilege of position after having as many years of experience as we've had and having done so much work, it never took away from the fact that we knew who the White Tiger was in this movie. Mm. All of us are here to support Balram's story. And that was our jobs. And it still is our jobs. And there was such a clarity about it, that whatever we needed to do, Raj and I, and every Mahesh sir, Vijay sir, everybody else, we knew that it was in support of what Balram needed in that circumstance, it was his story to tell. And I think that was the beauty of it, because it took away the pressure from everyone, and it just put it all on others.
That is a sly form of generosity. Yeah,
I didn't really get the chance to say this, Raj, but I think as an actor, you have to be really lucky if you get to work with somebody like Ramin, because you feel like you've tasted blood with Ramin. Ooh. And I truly mean that, because the amount of artistic freedom that he gives you, and the how personally connected you feel to a project. The amount of trust, the amount of trust that he places in you as an actor is just incredible. You know, like right from the beginning, I don't think Ramin ever told me that this is what it is. Like, at every junction of the film, including when we were shooting for scenes, he would always tell me, we'll keep searching. We'll keep searching, and within that search, we'll find something. Like, you know, in spite of being a part of this story and the book for such a long time, he never told me this is how I exactly envision it, because he gave me that liberty to explore myself as an actor in Balram's character. And it's, I think movie magic happens when you leave that little bit of space for improvisation, you know. And just like making me feel so involved at every stage, you know, he would ask me things like, what are the things you feel would be in his office? What are the kind of clothes do you think? I'd never experienced that ever in my life. Because, like, you know, maybe while doing theater in film school, but like a director of Ramin's stature to ask me these questions, initially I was like, whoa, like, is he really asking me this? Like, can I say this? And then I would come up with my whacked out suggestions. And, you know, he was generous enough to let me flow with some of them. And He would never call action on set.
Oh yeah.
He would always say whenever you're ready. So all of a sudden you don't feel like a bot anymore. Because it feels weird when somebody says action. Like, you know, like now that when Ramin said whenever you're ready is when I realized it was so weird to be for that action word to be heard every time you were doing a scene. Because you felt like a bot. Like, okay, now you're ready, start. You press the start button and you start acting and then you say cut and then you stop and then you... So, but it's not like that, right? Because when you're playing a person, it's not like a mountain you're climbing, right? From the point that you've been told that this is who you are going to be playing, you believe that that is who you are. You don't look at him, you don't look at the character in third person. You believe that you are the person you're playing. So then that supports that vision when you say whenever you're ready instead of action. So just qualities like these. And, you know, like, I don't know if I'll ever get to work with anybody like him. And I just feel so spoiled as an actor to have worked on a set that Ramin was part of.
Not saying action definitely confused me when I first started working with him. After like 15, 16 years of like reacting to action, suddenly I was like waiting. I used to be cameras rolling and I'm like, waiting to go. And I was like, no one's saying action. And Ramin was like, oh, I don't say it. Just like whenever you're ready. Confusing in the beginning.
Good to know for the next time I'm on the set with Ramin.
I want to put tasted blood on my tombstone.
Yeah, I mean, come on. We are. So look, nice. I've said this to Ramin, and I mean it from the bottom of my heart. I mean, while I think there are a lot of positive things for our art form that have come from this era in terms of accessibility and the ability for, you know, so many people around the world to appreciate cinema through screens of all sorts. This is one movie, when I watched it, that I was utterly crushed, that I couldn't see with an audience, because I know they would have leaped to their feet with rapturous applause, and this conversation would have engaged with those audience members in a different way. So promise to all of you that whenever it's safe, we will arrange a screening, Netflix willing. And you know, the other thing is, I knew since it's a Netflix production that they would have the budget to fly Adarsh Gourav here first class and put him up in his fancy hotel and deal with all. I mean, what studios can afford him these days? But in all seriousness,
Adarsh and I had made so many plans. We were supposed to be going around LA, like, you know, we had, it's just all,
I know. So
by the way, Raj, he, just so you know, he's a trained actor, of course. He got a full scholarship to the best acting school in India, and he's already been signed by huge Hollywood agents as a huge Hollywood manager. And
that sounds right. That sounds right. So, and maybe next time, if he will, you know, give this old uncle in New York a chance, I'd be glad to welcome him to our theaters. But, you know,
I'm 27. I'm not as young as you think I am.
Well, I'm 48, so I'm not as young as you think either. So, but this is what you have to look forward to, brother. You know,
like, you don't look 48.
Frown, don't frown, man. You know, it's all good. Thank you all so much for being a part of this, and huge, huge congratulations.
Thank you.
So
much. Thank you for having us, Raj. Thank you to MoMA as well.
Stay safe.
Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.
Bye.